It's always good to fellowship with his people. You know, one of the things that we often looked at is our family, how important family is. And you know, we have our natural family, but it's also good to have God's family. To have that family that stands with you. That's one thing I love about the house of the Lord. To be able to come and share your concerns, your family, and they will pray for you.
Yes.
You know, and you know, to have people that will pray, you know, sometimes that's why I have a habit of if somebody gives me a prayer request, I like to write it down, because that way I have a record of it, and you don't forget. Because if somebody, you know, if you meet a lot of people during the course of the day, and this person prayed for you, you might forget it. But if I write it down, for years in my truck, when I drove from Walmart, I had a little cubbyhole right up here, and I had a prayer book up here. And so sometimes when I go out the gate, a driver, or it could have been the guard, would say, "Hey, Tim, would you pray for this boy?" I'd grab that and write it right down so I can remember to pray.
Amen.
You know, because a righteous man, that prayer availeth much.
Yeah.
Who's really going and really seeking God. And that's really what God wants. He wants that in his family, to be able to pray for one another, pray for your family. That's the best thing you can give your kids, if they can see you praying.
Amen.
I think that is a powerful, powerful thing. Because when they can pray on their own, that is powerful. You know, that they can go to God and they can seek God. That's what was so great about Jesus. When that veil was rent, then we could go in there. Where they used to just have the high priest went in there once a year, but now we can go boldly. We can come boldly to that throne. That is so powerful, to think that the Creator listens to you. I know sometimes I share the same thing, but the same thing's in my heart.
Yes.
And the same thing is to be able to have that. And Jesus is the same yesterday, day, and forever.
Amen.
You know, some people change. You know, one day may have mood swing and go this and that, you know.
Yeah.
How you doing? I'm up and down. But think about Jesus being the same every day.
Yes.
How consistent he is. And you know, he's about answering our prayers. He's about, you know, one thing about it, God loves us so much. And we don't want to forget that. This was just, I want to open with this. These were just some comments that they asked people from different parts of the world. This was a girl from Spain, and they asked her about family. And she said, "For me, that's a strong word. For me, it means to feel secure, to have someone who you can count on." Wow. "Who shares your problems, but also means to have respect for each other and responsibility."
Right.
That was over in Spain. But you know what? I've met students from different parts of the world, and we're pretty similar in what we want.
Yeah.
And then think about that translating to God's family. Now, this is another one. It said, and this is from a girl in Denmark, "Family is a really important word. I think it is a word we use about people we love." Isn't that something?
Yeah.
And that's it. You know, God puts a solitary in family. And he brings you here for a reason. You ever think why you came to a specific location, specific church? You know, I had an opportunity to move up here. See, 2007, my daughter had asked me about moving up here, and I had a good career going. But you know, when you feel God moving you, and then how God orchestrates you, you know, God is like the grand chess master. He can get you to the right location with the right people so you can build up one another. That's what God is about.
Amen.
You know, and sometimes we feel sad. I remember my pastor, I was one of the elders down at the church in Mount Pleasant, and he was kind of sad when, you know, had to move away. But he said, "Hey, when it's God's plans for your life, I'll be supporting you." Because God knows where to get you at. This is a couple of scriptures in Exodus chapter 3, and this is when Moses had turned aside, because I know Moses had a lot of questions to be on the backside of the desert for 40 years, and I'm sure he kind of wondered what God was going to do with his life, you know, because that's a long time. You know, the first few years, you know, you kind of was kind of getting used to it, but man, God hadn't talked to me in, you know, one decade, and you know, there's really not much going on in my life, and now it's 2 decades, then it's 3 decades, then it's 4 decades. Well, God's still working in your life.
Yeah.
You know, just because things are kind of silent, it doesn't mean there's not work going on. Because God always works. That's the thing about God. He always works from the inside out.
Yeah.
And that's where he works on. He works on our heart so we can be more like him every day. And that's what he looks, because that's what attracts people, is when you act like Jesus in those situations where everybody else is going to act like the world.
Right.
When everybody else is getting on, I don't like nicknames very much when they hurt a person. You know, you call them a nickname, and sometimes it's kind of easy to get swept up in that crowd because you got this group doing it and that group doing it. But when you have one person that don't do it and stands up and says, no, I don't appreciate that. You know, I'm not going to do that. Rather than criticize this person, why don't you spend time praying for them? Because you don't know what they're going through. That's what I found. Some of the strongest people that on the outside are really some of the weakest on the inside.
Right.
You know, and sometimes those people that may be bully or something like, they may have got bullied too somewhere in their life, you know, and they kind of take that on. But when you stop and say, hey, what's going on in your life? That's what people get turned around. That's why they will come to know Christ, is when they see somebody act differently. And then they ask, hey, wait, how come you're acting this way and everybody else? It's because I got the light in me.
Yeah.
And that light is Jesus Christ. And that makes a world of difference. Now, we know that when Moses turned around, and I'm going to read this section here, and this is in Exodus chapter 3. Now, Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back or west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb on Sinai, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire and yet was not consumed. And Moses said, now these two words turn your life around in Christ. He said this, I will. That's where it starts at. That's where, when you decide, I will seek Christ. I will follow Christ. I will. It starts with that. He said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight while the bush is not burned. And when the Lord saw, I love that. The Lord's looking. Mm-hmm. See? He looked, see where Moses turned around, turned aside. Right. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses.
Yeah.
Now, there's probably not too many of the Moseses out there. But we know God likes to say it twice, so there's no misunderstanding. I know the Moses we're talking about. Moses, Moses. Okay, and look, and he said, here am I. That's where it starts with. When God calls you, surrender it all. Here am I. You know, it said, Isaiah, who going to send? Send me. Send me. When you surrender all, man, God can use your life. And that's what it takes. And God said, and when he said, here am I, and God said, do not come near, but put your shoes off, for the place in which you stand is holy ground. Where God is there, it's holy ground. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And God's in the midst of this building right now. That's what's so powerful. Whether it's two or three touching green, God's in the midst. That's powerful when you can meet God every day. And also he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And this is important. What God was saying about the whole situation, that the Egyptians are still controlling the Hebrew slaves. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters and oppressors. For I know. See, God knows what's going on. Sometimes we wonder because we don't see God moving. But he says right here, for I know, God knows their sorrows and sufferings and trials. He knows what you're going through. Don't feel like you're alone, that somehow you're kind of isolated. God knows. And I love it. And he says this, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand and power of the Egyptians, to bring them up out of that land to a land good and large, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land of plenty. To the place of the Canaanite, Hebrite, and the place of the Canaanite, Hittite, Amorite, Perizzite, Hivite, and Jebusite. You see, do you hear that? I'm going to bring them up and bring them out.
Yes.
And that's what God's ready to do.
Yes.
Do in your life. You might have been struggling for a long time, but God's going to bring you up and he's going to bring you out.
Yes.
And all we have to do, our God, if we have anything to do, is to love God through it all.
Yes.
And trust God through it all. I tell you what, the thing about a train, if you get on the train and you stay on the track, the train eventually gets to the destination. You ever notice something? A derailed train goes nowhere.
That's right.
Right? Until they put it up on the tracks, get the track straightened out, and it keeps running. And that's what we got to do. Stay on the track.
Yeah.
You know, stay on the train. God's going to get you through. I tell you what, when he's a conductor, he's going to get us through all the way, right?
Amen.
We used to sing that song, County Mission Wednesday. You know, this train is bound for glory. Hallelujah. And our ticket's punched. Jesus punched the ticket. Come on, brother. We're going. So that's what we got to really look at God. So this morning, we're going to praise God. That's what we're going to do as we open this testimony service. We all got a testimony. The reason we're here this morning, that's a testimony. Because some people did not get up this morning. Amen. Some people were not able to come to church today. Amen. But we are here, and it's time to praise God and celebrate his goodness. Hallelujah. So we open this up. Who would like to testify this morning? Hallelujah. Yeah, come on, because I can keep going. I got a lot of stuff here. I can keep going. You know, because God's exciting to me to see what he's going to do next. That always excites me. See how he's going to move. Another time, another day. You know, God, that's, I'm always amazed how God takes you from point A to point B. And he loves you so much, he's not going to keep you just at this place. That's why my better half, we talked when we first was dating. One thing about, she always say, I accept the good, the bad, and the ugly. You know, she used to say that. Say, well, we'll try to get rid of the ugly part, but the good, bad, the ugly. But you're saying you accept them all. You accept all the parts. When you love somebody, you got to accept their past, present, and their future, where they come from. And that's what God does for us. See, that's the difference between other religions. Other religions want you to clean up your act. Oh, you got to quit smoking, quit drinking, quit doing this. God said, wait. No, no. We're going to accept you just as you are.
That's right.
You know, the fascinating about the prodigal son, the most fascinating part was when, you know, the son's in the far country. He wastes all his money. You know, he's down to eating pig slop. We had pigs when we was little, you know, growing up. And I thought, man, you know, buddy, that's pretty desperate.
Yeah.
You know, because pigs beat anything. I mean, you know, we had to slop the hogs. I said, go down and slop the hogs. They need anything. Boy, when you're thinking about eating that, it's time to go home.
Yeah.
Say, hey, wait a minute. At least my servants at home, Dad's her, the servant, they eat better than what I'm thinking about eating right now.
Yeah.
You know, and they got more enough to spare. Tell you what, he started thinking, started turning. He didn't have any money. Nobody's giving money. He's thinking, maybe I need to start home. But I got to get a speech, you know, because my dad, I know he's not going to be happy with me. And I got to give a speech. And I'll say, listen, I'm sorry. I sinned against you. I don't even want to be your son. I'll just be one of the servants. Don't call me a son. So, you know, he finally gets home. And it's always interesting, how did the dad know which day the son was coming home? I don't think he did. I think what he did, he went out there and looked every day.
Yeah.
I think he was praying, went out to the mailbox. We look at the monitor. Went out to the mailbox. God, bring my son home. Go out there, don't see anybody. Okay? Maybe not today, but tomorrow. So he walks out there every day, every single day, looking for his son. Praying for a son, believing for a son. God, turn him around.
Yeah.
Whatever it takes to turn him around. And then one day,
the
old man walks out to the mailbox, and he sees a figure. And he just sees a figure, and figure's kind of walking with his head down. You know, imagine, he wasn't walking proud. You can tell that.
Yeah.
Didn't have no shoes, all shabby and smelling. He just kept thinking about his message. And his dad sees him, and the Bible says he ran toward him. That is powerful.
Yeah.
He ran toward her,
you
know? And his son's got this speech, and, you know, dad and everything. It's like dad didn't want to hear the speech. You know what he wanted to hear? You're home.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he wanted to hear. You're home.
Right.
You know, you stand now, you're alive, you're home, you're my son. Hey, I tell you what, boys, get the pig on. Get the fatted calf. Let's go. Let's get some food up here. Let's get the robe on. Let's put a ring on his finger. It's time to celebrate because he's home. That's how God feels about you. You know, he's not there. That's when you got to realize that. That's when you got to realize what God feels about you. He loves you that much. Don't feel like, look, I've done too much. I tell you what, there ain't nobody can go past grace. I tell you, God can reach down a long way.
That's right.
And David said, you know, in the psalm, so I make my bed in hell. I always say, if you make his bed in hell, he's planning on staying there for a while.
Yeah.
If you get up and make your bed. But God can still go down there. God can still pull you out. That's how much he loves you. It's not satisfying that anybody's in hell, going to hell. Guess not God wants. God wants all his family home. I got to share this one thing. One time I was at Six Flags. I got four boys, and two of them went off, and they was running around. So we was looking for them, ended up going to security, trying to have them. We was going to meet at a place, and they wasn't there. And then we went to security, and we tried to find them, and they was looking for them. And then finally I found one. The youngest one actually come. We saw him. I said, "Where's your brother at?" "Well, he's around here, you know." And I said, "Oh man." And I remember I had three at that point. And I know I probably shouldn't have said this, but I'm always going to be honest when I preach. I said, "God, I'm sorry. I got four sons. I need them to all come home. Yeah. Three ain't good enough. I'm sorry, God." And I probably shouldn't have said it that way, but I said, "I got four sons. I need them all to come home. Yeah. Every one of them." Yeah. And here comes my oldest. He's just walking down like, I've been worried the whole time. He's just walking down. And I saw him, and I went to him, and I hugged him. "John, you know, I'm sitting there hugging him. And, you know, scary, I think he found him. I think he found him now. You know, I'm just hugging him, you know. I didn't get on his case or nothing. I just hugged him. Thank you, God. They're all home." Yeah. And that's what God wants, all of you to come home. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Yes. Hallelujah.
Around
instead of criticizing those people, we should fervently be praying for them.
Amen.
Because there, and you mentioned it, Tim, there was a time that Elijah thought he was the only one.
That's right.
You know, and what happens is this generation hasn't seen the power of God. They've heard about it. They've read about it, but they haven't seen it.
Hallelujah.
So they get to a point where it's like there's a whole lot of agnostics, what I call today. They don't really disbelieve, but they really don't believe. And, you know, so we as believers, we are always, or maybe I'm speaking for myself, prompting the Lord that, you know, you really need to do something.
Right.
You need to show yourself, you know.
That's right.
You know you're there, but they don't. But he said in his own time and for his own name's sake,
right,
will he reveal himself. So we should be excited because I want to tell you what, there is going to be a revival that is going to hit again because this nation needs to be revived.
Hallelujah.
We're in the death throes, you know. We've let everything that is godly, we've shoved it out of the way, pushed it out of the way, and because God has not struck down anybody, they become bolder and bolder. And you know what? Your first instinct is, boy, he's going to get you. No, he has left the door open. You know, when the ark, Noah and all the animals went in the ark, I am blown away that that door stayed open for 7 days. All those people came every day and mocked him because, you know, now I'm sure when the animals went aboard, that didn't give them pause to think.
Mm-hmm.
But they still didn't see nothing. But once the raindrops fell and they come and beat on that door, now they were dealing with the eternal spirit,
right.
Jehovah. We are dealing with the eternal spirit that became human.
Right.
And had that human body is the buffer between us and God. He remembers not as a spirit, but as a human being what it's like.
Yeah.
Thank God judgment has gone to him and not to the eternal spirit, or we would be held to the same account, the angels and everyone else. We have redemption. I'll tell you what, it's fantastic. The thing that God has gone, put forth, for us,
yes,
is incredible. The angels looked into it.
Yeah.
What is this thing, salvation? How do these mortals get a second chance and we didn't?
Yeah.
We better hang on. You know, we have absolute authority. Mm-hmm. He gave us dominion,
yes,
over everything on this planet.
Sure.
And if we would ever realize we have dominion over the weather, we have,
yes,
dominion,
we do,
over everything.
Yes, we do.
Mm-hmm.
Not just the animals and so on. No, but we have dominion over everything. And he told us to do it.
Yes.
Jane and I were talking and I said, you know, I'm beginning to see something's working in my head about the faith. You know, how do we instill faith in people? Listen, they don't have to have any faith. If we have faith that he will honor what we say and do, we can pray for somebody. How are the dead going to have faith? He,
yeah,
said you're going to raise the dead.
Yeah.
Now think about that. See, we have to realize that that's reality.
Yeah.
The fact that we haven't seen it happen doesn't mean anything. We should expect it every day.
Amen.
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 That's right.
Amen.
Amen. Good. 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 Mike. Hallelujah.
Toby was going to give him a purchase order from White House to pay for it. The guy looked at us and says, no charge.
Hallelujah.
He went to bless him on the side and said,
yeah,
no charge.
Hallelujah.
So thank God for that, and thank for Toby and those that were able to help in that situation. On another note, at the last prayer burn up in Ankeny, the Lord showed me a spiritual mountain of God being built in the Midwest. That he's going to move in our midst. I didn't understand the full realm of what was going on after I saw it in part, didn't see the completion. Well, that time, or starting at that time, I didn't know about it until about 2 weeks later, that in West Virginia, on this side of the Appalachian Mountains, God has dropped his presence. And there's a point where it started with the children, started with the youth in their high schools. It got to the point where they were canceling proms because they wanted to go in the stadium just to see God's face.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Okay, so, Pastor.
I just want to say something very simple. We've got our youngest grandchildren, when they come stay with us, we've got to where we have them pray before we eat. Just little things to stay connected with the Lord. And their prayers are the one that Mom had taught them, that God is great, God is good, and we thank him for our food. It was just very simple.
Yes, sir.
And that's what everybody needs to know.
Yes.
Amen.
Not just our grandchildren, not just our children, not just
that's
us.
Right.
That's what the world really needs to know. That God can do anything.
Amen.
He's willing to do anything on our behalf.
Mm-hmm.
And he's good.
Yes.
Yes.
That, I don't think you could preach a better sermon.
No.
If you could just figure out some way of saying it, you know,
mm-hmm.
in a bunch of different ways. But that's the reality. And if children learn that early on, not just, you know, it's just wrote to them right now, and, you know, it's just repetitious thing, but even that can become a seed.
That's
that
right.
Attracts them that God is good. That God, no matter what we're going through, God can do something about it.
Amen.
And he will because he's good.
Amen.
Amen.
And that's the thing people need to know. God's not mad at them.
Right.
Even if we're mad at them, God's not mad at them. We may not like what they're doing. We may not like the way they're doing it. But we still, all of us, even the unsaved, are living in a time of grace. They're
yes.
living in a dispensation of grace. That's why we don't see retaliation. That's why we don't see God sending death and destruction into people's lives, because he wants them to know. It's the love of God that draws people to repentance. Sadly, for most people, they don't respond to the love. They end up responding to the misery and the destructive behaviors in their lives and turns to God. But he's still good, and it's still his love that's there waiting for him.
Yes.
Amen.
But for whatever reason they turn to God, for whatever reason they cry out to God in their mustard seed faith,
yes.
mm-hmm.
he's still there to embrace him, to love him, to forgive him, and to be there for him. And that's what people need to know. That's, I mean, we want to see miracles, because some people are never going to come to God without one.
Right.
But that is a miracle. That is the greatest miracle for people to know, in spite of all my dysfunction, God still loves me.
Yes.
Amen.
God still wants to save me. God still wants to be there for me and be my father and bring me into the family of God.
Amen.
Yes.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Yes.
And, you know, in my physical and everything that's going on in our lives, it's been really Right.
But what you never thought. And I tell you, the morning is my worst time. But I get up in the morning, and every morning for a while now, I'm getting up and sitting there, and I'm just like, for me, everything's kind of gone. I'm trying to bring things back together. You know, some memory loss is there. But I look out, and there's two doves that have been coming up every morning. And I sit there, and it's right out my, where I can see right out my sliding glass doors, and where I sit every morning, and there they are, and they stay there all morning. And to me, it's just like a, I see them, and it's just a word from God to me that peace, peace,
yeah.
Be still. Everything's going to be all right.
Amen.
You just got to trust in me and have the peace. And sometimes they just stay for the morning, and I'm feeling better by the afternoon, and really rough day. Those doves will be there all day long.
Amen.
Back,
yeah.
And just like a presence to me, and I'm going to thank God for that, because I'm telling you, I've never seen them before,
yeah.
Never had them before, in all the years we've been there, and there they are now,
mm-hmm.
And I just want to thank God for that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. That's awesome. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, brother.
God, you said, read there about God. He said, I see.
Mm-hmm.
I see. I know what's going on. Well, a while back, I was a little troubled, and I was wanting to visit with somebody, and I couldn't. But he says, here I am, here I am.
Uh-huh.
And he says, I know what you're going through. You lost your daddy, and that grieved me tremendous. And he says, no, I was estranged from my daddy, and that was hell, you know. I know what you're going through. And he says, you died and come back? Well, I died and come back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know what you're going through. And so the relativity, the closeness, the relativity of God, knowing, you know, He knows what's happening,
mm-hmm.
and we think we're just doing it on our own. Oh no, He's there, and also I'd like to put a prayer request in for Deborah, the one that usually comes with us, but. She feels rather condemned and is herself doing. I mean, this is her evaluation. But usually I can, you know, think things through and help somebody. But she has a twist in her understanding and rejection, even rejecting God, Jesus. And yet she wants the spiritual life. And I am befuddled. I don't know, but I know somebody that does.
Yeah.
Amen.
And I'm, you know, just rolling it over on him. And if, you know, you could pray for Deborah.
Yes.
And she's a very confused person. And miserable, because where she's at is total misery. She thinks she hears from God, and what you know what she says that she heard don't sound like from God. And I keep telling her, you know, there's two voices, but God knows and God understands, and it's in His it's you know it's so big. God's got to do it.
That's right.
I can't talk her out of it. I can't talk, you know. It's beyond me.
Mm-hmm.
And I just trust in the Lord. Yeah. And He will.
Yes.
He will.
Yes.
By His faith in.
Amen.
Amen.
Yep. That's awesome. Yeah, we might not have all answers, but we know the answer man, God Jesus. Christ Jesus. That's what we need to point Him to. Because He's got all the answers. You know, we might not know Him, but we know one thing we can do is we can pray for Him. And that's the best thing you can do. Yes.
Praise the Lord. A lot of times I spend so much of my time trying to maybe convince myself and everyone.
Hallelujah.
That's already taken care of.
Yeah.
Amen.
My dysfunction is not a secret.
Amen.
I mean, even if I try
yeah.
to keep it a secret.
Yeah.
So it's just a great thing to, you know, really come to the understanding of that. And it's not a license, but at the same time, you know, it's not like he doesn't already know.
Right.
Amen.
It makes it over and over abundantly clear that that is the case.
Amen.
And there's that's kind of the, it's not kind of, there's a big issue with a lot of people that think, well, I do this, and, you know, I know that's not accepted. Well, not accepted by who?
Mm-hmm.
You're making stuff up, and so you try to, it's like a ministry outside of the walls of the church is that, you know, people see me, they hear what I say, they see how I act, and then I don't walk around in long flowing robes with a big dangly cross around my neck, but once they find out, because I don't broadcast it, but they'll say, well, I heard you were a minister, I heard you were in the ministry, I heard, so what's that got to do with anything? Oh, well, you know, I didn't think you could do things and say things like that. Well, be that as it may, nevertheless, I still know who God is, and God knows who I am.
Amen.
So it's not a matter of getting rid of whatever you got in your life, because he already knows. So just come to him. Come to him as you are.
Amen.
I want to thank everybody for, you know, their continual prayers for not just our family, but, you know, requests that I put in. One of the guys on my sales team, you know, I try to interject God, you know, how it is at work, you know, some things you can get away with and some things you can't. So I try to interject different teachings. We have a meeting every Monday mornings for 3 hours. I train these guys on the state of the business, but, you know, I try to throw things in there so that, you know, they obviously know where I stand, and, you know, you try to find out through what you do say is if, you know, people will respond to it and not be, you know, offended by it. But one of the senior guys on my team went for his annual, just to get a shot for his allergies. So the doc did a full evaluation. He had him open up and go, and he goes, do that again. And he did it again. Well, he had his tonsils out. And he asked me, he said, you had your tonsils out as a kid? Yeah. He goes, well, there's a spot there. We need to get it checked out. Turns out he's got throat cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he came to me, and, you know, I said, man, I'll have people all over the country praying for you immediately.
Right.
And so I put it out there. And so he went in for surgery, and they found it. First off, they did a biopsy on his thyroid. Absolutely nothing wrong. Then when they did the surgery to take the tumor out, it was the smallest tumor he's ever seen in 20 years of practice.
Hallelujah.
And he's got a clean bill of health.
Hallelujah.
That's who my God is.
That's awesome. That's awesome. That's how God works.
That's right.
That's exactly how God works. You know, prayer just makes such a difference. And then when you can have people, the body of Christ, they can be clear across the world and pray for your needs here. I mean, I just think prayer is awesome. You know, it's a privilege. That's a song, privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. To be able to do that and hear that God's listening. That just is awesome. Anyone else? We're gonna pray. Yes. Amen.
But what I wanted to let you guys know, to remind you, that we should open ourselves up to Him to speak to us in the night seasons, to give us visions and dreams, and to just say, I dedicate, you know, myself to you, that you can speak to me, you can tell me things in the night seasons, you can
do that. We will definitely pray for somebody.
There's a temp worker at my work. She's in her mid-30s, and she had just last week found out that she had something on her thyroid. So they did a biopsy. I don't know the whole story. She just told me a little bit of it. We're supposed to have the results this tomorrow. However,
Heidi, okay. We'll pray for Heidi. James? Amen. Thank you, James. Praise the Lord. Praise
God. I think that we need to remember that we battle not against flesh and blood.
Right.
Now, if Paul told the people that if the princes of this world had known who Jesus was, they would not have killed him. And I think so many times, listening and thinking myself, we do not pray as the proper enemy. We pray against situations and so on instead of about the perpetrator of that situation.
Right.
Daniel, we see that there were princes, the prince of Persia, the prince of Greece. They are spiritual rulers of this world. That's who we are battling against, and we seldom even look their direction. We look at what the damage they cause, but we have in our power to come against those powers and principalities. But we don't do it because we think small. I tell you, God has really revealed to me about the authority he gave us.
Yes.
It's so much greater than we imagine.
Yeah.
But it's kind of like having a great big weapon and shooting a sparrow with it, when it'll bring down an elephant. I'm concentrating on the sparrow. We need to realize who the enemy is.
Right.
And I'll tell you, I'm talking to myself because I have these conversations with myself all the time. You know, there is so much God's trying to tell us, but we're so noisy that we're not listening to what he's saying.
Amen.
He has given us authority, and we need to realize what it is and how to use it.
Yes.
Amen.
How do I use his name? Do these things in Jesus' name. Well, how that's been working at me. There's a way and an authority that we have that we just haven't unlocked.
Amen.
It's
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. That's good. Thank you. Yes.
Just a side note on that of the thyroid. Oh, I don't know how many years ago, quite a few. I noticed mine swelling up. And finally I said something to my wife, you got to go to the doctor. You know, well, I knew that's what she'd say. But anyway, finally, you know, went to the doctor and she says, oh, you got to have a sonogram. And sure enough, two solid nodules found. And of course, I was going to church where they prayed for you. And I went up front to get prayed for. And they did. And so it ended up that I went to the original doctor and he says, we got to have a biopsy, you know, he got all excited and so I went to another fellow, you know, he wasn't the original one that did the sonogram. I knew that was having some kind of trouble. And finally he says, I don't think you're a candidate for a biopsy. And he says, I'm going to talk to the doctor. And of course, you know, sometimes doctors have, you know, strange ideas. I said I wanted a biopsy. I got a guy. So he worked and worked and finally got enough evidence for a biopsy. And then on the report, I forgot about getting the report from the doctor. And I went back, got the report. And 2 weeks later, from the first one, the report said, no nodules found.
Hallelujah.
Wow. You know, but I still had there was a lot of things going on in my throat, and I still had a kind of a tentacle on my Adam's apple, and I went to church, and they prayed for that, and Monday morning it was gone, and I have never done anything more with I've got good thyroid.
Hallelujah. That's awesome. Well, can we go ahead and stand up for prayer, please? Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, we thank you for all the testimonies here today. Lord, we thank you for being here with us. We thank you for the miracles that you have done because it was only you. Lord, we ask you to be with Sheila Legs and just Lord, just work in that situation, Lord, and the needs that was represented today to give Peter the right job, Lord, and be with Debbie, be with Jim, be with all these different situations that we bring to you today, because we serve a mighty God, a wonderful God, a God that works miracles. Hallelujah. For with God, all things are possible. Lord, we thank you for how you moved in our lives. We thank you for how you worked and continue to work. Hallelujah, because you're the same God, yesterday and day and forever. Lord, we thank you. The Bible said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I will bless you, Lord, at all times, good times, bad times, no matter what may happen. I know that you are with me. Lord, Father God, we thank you so much that you are in this building today. We thank you so much. We surrender our will to you. Have your own way, Lord. Have your own way, Lord. Change a life. That's what it's about. Thank you for working up on us from the inside out, making us new creatures in Christ. Lord, all those needs, all those desires, Lord, you are the deliverer. Lord, you are the provider. Lord, you are the one that healeth. Lord, we thank you. We thank you because we serve a mighty God. We serve a God that's bigger than all our problems. You know what's going on in our lives. You're still working on us. You're still loving us. Oh, Lord, we ask you to put your arm around each and every one of us. Just tell us over and over, God, you are love, that you love us. You love us. You want to love us more and more and more. And, Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. Thank you for never leaving us or forsaking us.
Lord, as we go deeper into the service, let your Holy Spirit have the right of way. Because it's all about you. It's all about you. Said if you be lifted up, you draw all men unto you. And we're going to lift you up today. Father God, today may you get the glory in our lives. We thank you for the blessings. Lord, we thank you for what you've done in our past. We thank you for what you're doing now.
Hallelujah.
And we're going to thank you ahead of what you're going to do in the future. Because Lord, you are wonderful. Mighty counselor. God above all gods. And we thank you. We thank you, Lord, in your wonderful holy name. Amen,
amen.
And amen. Hallelujah. Please turn off the phones. We're going to speak the word. Speak it out. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you?
Hallelujah.
I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Hallelujah.
Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body function to the perfection to which God created to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Don and John, come up. Take the offering, please. Thank you. Okay. John, if you would pray.
Just blazing the path and revealing the worship songs, even in what you and others have brought forth this morning, which obviously I believe is tying into what Pastor's going to preach on, even though we don't know what it is yet. The Lord does. Hallelujah. 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 When I walked in here this morning, and even yesterday, I heard the echoes of Friday night, the house of prayer in here, and I can't shake it. There was an open heaven here Friday night. Brother Ron, can you elaborate what the Lord was showing you?
Thank you.
Thank you, brother. That's what I was hearing. That's what we were seeing.
Yes.
Jamie?
Yes.
Same question. We didn't see much of you. You were. Based on what you both said, was the old song of joy unspeakable and full of glory. The Lord wants to move in this place.
Yes.
He wants to move mightily.
Yeah.
And it's by His love and His grace and His mercy it's going to happen. It's not going to be by condemnation. It's not going to be by religion or doctrine. We already understand that. The neat part about it is, I believe it's going to start through the young ones. It's going to start through the young ones. Through the pure in heart also. There aren't many of them here. But it only takes two or three to spark a forest fire. And there are so many children in this neighborhood that need the Lord. We see them riding on their bikes on the weekends and stuff. And they need the Lord. They need the Lord. So we're going to continue on from Friday night. I can't shake it. I just can't shake it. I can't shake it. Thank you.
Lift your voice, church. Just lift your voice and worship him. He is worthy of our praises. There's healing in his wings. There's healing in his wings. As we abide in the shadow of his wings, claim your healing right now in Jesus' holy name.
Yes, Lord.
It's all about you, Lord. It's all about you, Lord, for you, Lord, are worthy. Call out your need, church. Just call it out. Just pray. Just pray. Just call out the things of the Lord. He is here and he wants to touch you right now. No matter what it is, Abba Father loves his children. Abba Father loves his children. Yes, Lord. I can feel your mighty power, and it's moving in this place. Jesus.
is the realm of your glory. This is the realm of your grace. I can feel your mighty power, and it's moving in this place. La da da, 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 la da.
Sing it again.
La da da, la da da. In the presence of angels, with God's glory on their wings, I hear the voice of many waters, I can hear the angels sing.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for the words of encouragement, for inspiration, for revelation that comes from your people by your Spirit. We bless you this morning, Lord, and thank you for every good and perfect gift that comes from you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you are unchanging. No variableness nor shadow of turning, but the same yesterday, today, and forever. Everything you've ever done, you're continuing to do. And we thank you for it and the confidence that it gives us in Jesus' name. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, everybody, for sharing your testimonies and prayer requests. I also want to thank Mike for his hard work over the last several months of getting the steeple and the cross and the whole thing back together, and thank Toby and Andy Wyckoff for making that crane available. And without that, we wouldn't have had it. Whether he charged us anything or not, we'd still be out there with ropes and pulleys trying to get it up on the roof. So that was a great blessing, and I appreciate Toby being there to help Mike up on the roof. Because I don't go up on roofs anymore. I reached the age of accountability. I think that's when you start paying for your own insurance, but I'm not sure. Amen. So, but I was glad to see them up there, and it went fast. I got here about, yeah, praise the Lord. I got here about 8:05, and the crane was backing up and getting ready to pull out. So my timing was perfect. But yeah, I mean, they were going to start at 8 o'clock, and they weren't messing around. He got here 5 minutes early, and it was on the roof, and I don't think it took more than 6-8 minutes to get it up there. Of course, it took a good part of the rest of the day to get everything finished up, but the biggest challenge was getting there in the first place. So thank you, Mike. I appreciate it very much. And everybody involved, amen, it's a good thing. We got it back up, and if you didn't notice it or hadn't seen it on Facebook or didn't notice it when you came in, look up on your way out. It looks really good. It looks better than it ever did before. And it'll be there for a long time, at least longer than I'll be here probably. Praise the Lord. So, amen. Anyway, God is good, and we're grateful for all that he does and how he does put people together. And, you see good things that people do, and we're always grateful to the individuals. But really, it's more about their sensitivity to God and being willing to let God speak to them and them then respond in a way that's a tremendous blessing. And so we're grateful for that, grateful to God and grateful to the people who are sensitive to the Lord and willing to be generous, amen, help to further what God's trying to do, amen. Not what he's trying to do, what he is doing, and we're trying to cooperate with, amen. So I'd like to get right into this morning, and I want us to read, I'll just read one verse of scripture here from Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 11, and this really is, I believe, what we've all been talking about here this morning, and it is about the kingdom as well, because he said that the kingdom was in us, which leads me to believe then that that kingdom is actually the person of Jesus Christ. And I don't have a realm of kingdom castles and armor and moats and all that stuff, but I have the king. Wherever the king is, you can bet that's where the kingdom is, right? So it's just there's more about the way we think about these things than what the reality is. I thought it was interesting that not only did you say that, well, I don't, you know, I really don't remember what I said. I just know I said it. I knew it was right at the moment. Amen. And once I said it, it's like I don't remember saying it. I think Jamie said pretty much the same thing. And that's because this is by the Spirit, and a lot of things that God does, we don't really understand it even when he's doing it. It's usually after the fact that we begin to understand that. And Ron, I know that, you know, you feel like, whoa, I should have known, I should be able to recall that. But actually, things happen all the time in the Spirit. Not only don't we recall it, we didn't even know it happened when it happened. And I mean, you think about Peter and John and them, and when they're walking past the gate, beautiful, and there's a guy there, and people are getting healed by their shadow. They're not doing anything other than just they're there. So the kingdom has come. That's what Jesus told him. He said, "The kingdom is nigh you. It's coming." Well, it couldn't come until after his death, burial, and resurrection, for the Spirit to be released, the Spirit of God in Christ. And so when that Spirit was released, the kingdom was released. So it isn't so much whether we understand all about the kingdom as it is about us recognizing that we are the kingdom, that the kingdom is in us. And so whatever that kingdom declares to be reality, it comes by us. It comes by where we go. It comes by our location, our belief, our acceptance, and then our declarations as a result of it. We are kings and priests, a nation, amen, of kings and priests. And whatever a king says is law. God's given us this kind of authority so that when we speak, the dominion, everything within the sound of our voice, within the system of this authority, has to respond. It has to bow. So it's not that we don't have the kingdom, it's that we don't necessarily understand it or recognize how it actually works. And so I want to talk to you about some of those things in a little backhanded way, maybe, but let's begin here and we'll just move on. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. Now, I don't, I may have shared the generality of this particular statement before, but I don't sleep real good. In fact, I wake up in the middle of the night, literally every night, and I hear noises. I hear the house creaks, and the wind blows, and the dog barks, and now that he's getting old, he's in the house, and he doesn't know how to lay down. He just, it's like he's jumping off of something all the time. He doesn't get on anything. It's just that when he sits down or lays down, he just flops. And you could, he weighs about 120 pounds or something probably. Well, he used to. He probably doesn't weigh that much now. But it's still, you can hear the thud from the other room where he's lying. And so that I'm listening to all these sounds, and I have a tendency to replay the events of the day in my mind. I kind of like review all the conversations I had, and of course I improve my part of those conversations. I was really smart in the middle of the night that I wasn't so smart during the day when I was having the conversation. All these witty sayings come back to me, and what I should have said and could have said and might have said and all that. And so I brood over the past, and I fret about the future. Now, I know that isn't real encouraging for you when you hear it from your pastor, but that's the fact. That's just the way it is. And as my watch on the nightstand counts down the remaining hours, I lie in the dark and I wait for the windows to lighten up by the light of the morning sun. It's not frightening as much as it is just uncomfortable. I want to go back to sleep. I don't want to be thinking everything I'm thinking. But I can't make myself go back to sleep. If you would, turn to Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. I'm not asking for confessions, but my guess is this happens to everybody, some more than others. Maybe some of it's age, maybe some of it's the more you live, the more experiences you have, the more you've got to remember. And maybe the less certain the future is in natural terms. So I guess that part of it's normal, but when I was young, I'd stay up till 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, and I could sleep till noon. Now I can't stay up past 9, and I'm awake at 3. So go figure, you know. But come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Praise the Lord. My early mornings are what I think of as shadow lands of grace. Now, I don't want to wax poetic here, but when I'm awake all night, I got lots to think about. So I think of those times as kind of the in-between, the gray areas of grace, where the lines blurred between what God only can do for me and what I think I have to do for myself. But rest is more than an occasional side effect of doing all the right stuff. Rest is more than just a byproduct of obedience. Jesus said, "Come unto me." Rest is a destination. And it's a mark of grace. It's evidence of grace. Jesus doesn't call us to leave our comfort zone. He actually calls us to find our comfort zone. Jesus doesn't tell us to organize our lives more responsibly and create some space there for rest. But Jesus talks of rest as something that we find. And that rest is objective in the sense that it's not in me. I can't produce it. It's something that lies outside of me, separate from me. Rest isn't an inner state that can be produced by thinking a certain way. You know, we think if we just get enough answers, we'll figure it all out. Rest isn't something that is produced by just me getting the right thought patterns or thinking correctly or disciplining my thoughts or putting myself in the right situations and conditions where I'm relaxed. Rest is something other than that. Rest is something more than that.
Yes.
It's obtained only by entering into the relationship. It's the relationship that offers us rest.
Yes.
Because Jesus is offering himself. Come unto me. I'll give you rest. Because I am rest. He's the Prince of Peace. So we forget sometimes that we're looking for answers outside of the person. In other words, we think, if I learn enough, then I can just do stuff. You'll never learn enough. Only God knows the future. Only God knows everything. It's Him that we need. It's He that gives us rest. It's Him that provides grace, peace. It's a position. It's a location. Look at John chapter 16 and verse 33. I got a feeling if I slept as much now as I did when I was younger, I wouldn't have any wrinkles at all. I wouldn't need this beard to cover them up. Although it's not really working that great because now it's so white that it doesn't really trick anybody. And, you know, I just can't go down that road with the black hair and beard anymore because, come on. It's obvious this guy's using shoe polish or something on this because that can't be right. He can't look that old and have that dark of hair. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation. Outside of Him, we got tribulation, and we've heard it this morning. And God knows, you know, I've got to where I won't even listen to the news. In fact, I won't even let Sally tell me what's on the news. She's trying to get angry and wanting to get me angry with her, and I just, I don't want to know. I can't do anything about those individuals. All I can do is trust God. Pray and believe that in spite of how chaotic everything looks, He's still in control.
Yes.
Amen. So in the world you'll have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. In me, you have peace. So during these long nights when I lay awake in bed and I can't will myself to sleep, I clear my mind of what's happened that day, and I imagine like I'm lying on a beach, and I try to hear the waves, and you know what I'm saying? Just try to disconnect. I'll count backwards from 100. I pray, but nothing works. I'm still awake. The more I pursue it, the more elusive sleep becomes. It's weird. If I didn't want to, if I'm just sitting in the chair, I'll be asleep in 5 minutes. But when I want to sleep, I can't sleep. And the harder I try to sleep, the more difficult it is. And yet, if I wait long enough, sleep eventually claims me. It's this morning. I don't know what time it was. I don't look at the clock anymore when I first wake up because that's just discouraging. Because I know then I got 3 hours, 3.5 hours before there's going to be daylight. And I don't like getting up stumbling around in the dark. Besides, I know I need to be sleeping. So somehow, at some point, sleep claims me. And I don't know it till I'll wake up an hour or so later. Can we get a picture with that? But despite my wanting it and this long delay, sleep's arrival always comes suddenly. Without my even knowing it. Sleep comes to me as a surprise. And it's the same way with Jesus. We pursue him. We think we're pursuing him when in fact we have him all the time. And he just manifests at some point, and it's a shock. Because we've prayed, we've longed, we've asked, we've sought, you know? And it's not like he wasn't there all the time. It's just like my trying to get him, I finally wear out, and I find out that he's already got me.
Yes.
And it's a shock. It's a surprise. When we really find Jesus, and I'm not talking about being saved. I'm talking about all the things we've talked about here this morning. When we really find him, we're surprised that when we find him, we rest. Everything that was so tormenting, everything that was so frightening, everything that was so dysfunctional, all of a sudden seems to have a perfect flow, perfect reality. Really finding Jesus, you find grace. And in that grace, you find rest. Praise God. We talk about grace, we declare it, we claim it, but I'm telling you, from a rational, natural, mental reality is we struggle with this. We struggle with grace. This is the battle. That am I accepted? Am I okay? Am I doing everything? Amen? Jesus said, in me, you have peace. Since I'm making this all about me this morning, which is what I love to do, I was remembering, not last night, I think it was Thursday night or Friday night, a prayer that I prayed when I was a little kid. First prayer I ever prayed. My mother taught it to me. I was probably 4 years old, something like that. I know I wasn't in school yet, but it was, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Now, I can remember praying that every night, or nearly every night. For the first probably year, I had no clue what I was praying. I was actually praying this. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soldier keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soldier take. Because we had little army men back then, all kinds of them. I thought that's what it was, because I didn't know soul from soldier. It sounded like soldier, so that's what I said. But that was the first prayer I ever prayed, and as I got a little bit older, I'm sure that my mother intended this to teach me about God's care, about God being concerned. But I learned something else. It was taught to me to bring me comfort. It was a nightly reminder of my vulnerability and my mortality, even as a kid. And to me, the implication was that while I slept, my soul was in danger. And I needed protection, but the prayer didn't tell me from what. It told me that I might die during the night. And if I died, God might take my soul. The prayer didn't say what he was going to do with it, just that he would take it. I'm talking about, as a kid, theology just doesn't, you know, you don't understand all those things, so you're trying to deal with it in a rational way, and I'm not saying that I spent all of my childhood focused on this, but I did think about it. There was something unfriendly about the language. It was like theft. You know, screw up, he's taken it. He's taken your soul. And it didn't put God in a great light for me. It made him scary. It made him frightening. I didn't want to die in my sleep, and I sure didn't want God to take my soul. I wanted to keep it, and I wanted to wake up in the morning. It's no wonder I didn't want to close my eyes. I would pray the prayer. I was wide awake then. I'm thinking, man, I got to keep my eyes open here because something really bad could happen. But just like sleep, rest can be unnerving. We can't make it reality. We can't make sense of it. Look at Genesis chapter 2 and verse 2. On the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. Now, if you will, Sheila, go to John chapter 19, verse 30. So God ended his work, he rested from all of his work which he had made. Then when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." He bowed his head and gave up the ghost. See, God's rest is a rest of completion, not correction. He's done everything he's going to do. He's rested. And it's not a rest that I'm resting so that I can get on with this work. It's a rest that says it's all done. There's nothing more to be focusing on except entering into that rest, having this relationship with Jesus. Hebrews chapter 4, let's go back there again. To chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. For he that has entered into his rest, should be a capital H there, but he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his. Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. So God's rest is a destination, or it's a location. Amen. It's God's rest. It's his rest. Hebrews 4, verse 1. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. See, here's what I'm discovering. Before rest is a practice, it's an experience. Before it becomes continuous, it's just an experience. Before any of that, we have to receive it as a gift. And that's where we struggle. We're trying to will ourselves into rest, which screws us from the get. Pardon the vernacular, but I'm just saying. It just stops us from the very thing we're trying to achieve. Because before we can have any of the results of grace, any of the results of rest, we have to receive it as grace in the first place. And as long as we haven't done that, it can never become a reality, a practice. We can talk about it, we can believe it intellectually, but experientially is where it has to happen first before it can become practice. Rest is something that God just grants to us. It's part of our inheritance. It's his rest. and He gives His rest to us. And He gives it to us in the person of Jesus Christ, who is grace. Come unto me. That's what He's talking about. I'll give you rest. There is no rest outside of Him. There's no rest outside of grace. No matter how religious you are, no matter how good you are. Because this thing is grounded in work, but it's work that only God can do.
Right.
Nobody else can do it.
Amen.
Amen. Rest begins with God, not with us. It's like the land that was promised to Israel. It's ours only after we receive it from God as a gift and an inheritance. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 24. But I have said unto you, ye shall inherit their land, and I will give it unto you to possess it, a land that floweth with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God, which have separated you from other people. It's an inheritance. Amen? Now, the generation that left Egypt, they never received it from God. They never got it as a gift or an inheritance because they didn't believe the promise. They didn't believe it was a gift. They believed they had to do something in order to make it theirs. That's why the giants seemed so intimidating. If God had already given it to them, the giants don't mean anything any more than anything, because God's already won the battle. God's already gone before you. God's already taken care of it. God's already given you this land. Amen? Even when Joshua led the second generation into Canaan, they didn't find rest in the degree that God promised. They were still going through all kinds of struggles, trying to find rest, trying to possess the land. They never did really totally possess it. They didn't believe God completely either. Now here's what's interesting. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 8 and 9. And I've read this so many times, and you would think that I would have made the connection, but I don't know that I ever did. I mean, I know the generic kind of connection, but not the explicit, not the specific that God was and has been trying to show me. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would He not afterward have spoken of another day? There remaineth, therefore, because of that, there is a rest to the people of God. There remains a rest for us. And that means that the promise of rest is still open. It's still available. It's still ours by the same way that it could have been theirs, by believing the promise. Let me ask you a question. If you really believe in healing, are you going to lay awake nights anymore worrying about cancer or the diagnosis or the... You understand what I'm saying? If you really believe the promise of God, are you going to lay awake at night fretting over the checkbook when He supplied all of our needs according to His riches and glory? Do you understand what I'm saying? We say we understand it, and yet we struggle with the very same thing that the Jews struggled with. We have a problem believing the promise, and so we don't enter into His rest. Why? Because we believe, but we don't believe. It's like I was talking about last week. Let's go up and take Him. God is all-powerful. Maybe God will fight for us. We all live in the maybe world. We know He can do it. We know He can defeat the enemy. But our question is always, maybe He will. It's just like Israel, we experience divine rest, and we experience it starting with relocation. Their rest wasn't in the desert. Their rest was if they could get into the promised land, that was their rest. Amen? And the reality is, nothing has changed. for us to enter into this rest, we got to change locations. Out of the dominion of darkness, out of the natural, and into the kingdom of Jesus Christ, into the supernatural. Praise the Lord. We are supernatural beings, but we live our life 90% of the time naturally, which is why we don't have rest, which is why we don't have manifestation, which is why we don't have the kingdom manifesting. Out of our effort and into His finished work of grace. That's the location change. That's the change that has to take place. Again, it's, we can say it, but we have to experience before you can practice it. Seated with Him in heavenly places. Resting. Because it's done. It's finished. I won't have you go there, Sheila, for the sake of time, but Romans chapter 7, if you read verses 18 right on through 25, it's all natural stuff. It's all about Paul wanting to do the right thing but continuing to fail at doing the right thing. And the harder he tries, the more he fails. The more he tries to get into this rest, the more elusive the rest is. I'm just using the same analogy here. Because that's what he's after. He wants peace. He wants to rest. But the harder he tries to achieve the rest, the harder it is to achieve. The more elusive it becomes. Until finally he comes to the conclusion, but thank God for Jesus Christ and the finished work. And I'm paraphrasing, but that's the point that he's making, is Jesus has taken care of all of that stuff that I've been trying to do. And just as Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. And the very next verse is, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who have found rest, who have received it as a gift, who have accepted it by the grace of God. Amen? And in my footnotes in my Bible, not that I've written, but what the writers of this particular Bible put, the footnote is, who live in union. For those who are in Christ Jesus. And he says, for those who live in agreement with, or who live in union with, there's no condemnation. Why? Because they've found the rest. They've found the author and finisher of their faith. They've found the end-all and be-all of all of their existence. Amen? The righteousness of God in Christ. Hebrews, again, Sheila, back to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 10. For he that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. So when we enter into the works of Christ, we cease from our own works. But here's the point. We cease from our works, but the works don't cease. It's how Peter didn't have to get up there and, you're healed in Jesus' name. He ceased from his work. All he had to do was be in the area. He was at rest in what Jesus had already accomplished. And what happened? People are healed. Amen. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. And this will be the last scripture, but just to prove this, take this a little bit further. Entered into his rest, ceased from our own. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. He's already done it. We just walk in it. We rest in the finished work. We rest in Christ. See, you know, sleep is a form of rest, but not all rest is sleep. God rested on the seventh day, but he never sleeps. Physical rest comes to us when we yield to our weariness. But God never wearies. He never gets weary. He offers himself to us as a place of rest. He continues to work. Jesus said, I work because my Father works. And then Jesus said, but it's not me that does the work. It's the Father that's in me. He does the work. So he offers himself to us as a place of rest because he has invited us into his rest. Come unto me, all ye that labor. I'll give you rest. But here's the irony. Here's the conflict of mind and spirit. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor, and I'll give you rest. And then he says, wake up and walk in the light of his finished work. I'll give you rest. And then he says, wake up, stay awake. Stay awake to grace. And you'll always be at rest. And Christ is loosed to do what only Jesus can do anyhow, but asked to do it through us. But he can only do it through us if we're at rest, if we're in him and allowing him to do the work. Praise the Lord. It's easier said than done. It is like my nights of trying to get to sleep, only to suddenly have sleep come on me. And that's what I believe God is trying to show me through this, is that we're trying to live lives of grace. And if we would just quit trying so hard, grace would embrace us. Grace would claim us. And we'd really understand that this is a gift. It's nothing that we can earn. It's hard as humans to just relax and rest. Can you give the Lord a hand clap? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. So let's just rest. Take a break. Chill out. Relax. He's got it all under control. Amen. God bless all of you. Thank you again so much for being here this morning. May the Lord bless you and help you to enter into his rest. Praise God. Check out the steeple and the cross as you leave. It looks great. And you might thank the Lord for making it all possible. Amen. God bless you. You're all dismissed in Jesus' name.